you give her honor at all. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise. I want to go into John, the 12th chapter, real quickly. I'm going to read and share some truths that when you leave out of here today, you will leave out of here knowing without a shadow of a doubt that you can live a lifted life. Your life has been too low. You've been living beneath the privilege. You've been living beneath the price that Jesus paid for you. And today, you will never, ever be the same. Amen. I just feel like the Lord's going to do something special today. John 12, 23, and Jesus answered saying, the hour is come. Say, the hour is come. That the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. Now, when he said that corn of wheat, he was referring to his own life. That it would go into the ground, be buried as a seed would. But it has to die so that it can bring forth many more sons. Verse 25, if he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. Move down to verse 27. Now is my soul troubled. Now is my soul what? Now is my soul what? My soul is troubled. My soul is depressed. That's what he was saying, yes. And what shall I say? Because you got to be careful what you say when you're down. I'm going to say that again. He says, my soul is troubled. I'm down. But what should I say? What should I allow to come out of my mouth? Do you know your words have just as much power when you're down than when you're up? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Amen. He said, this is what I say. Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I into this hour. Father, glorify thy name. There came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. And people therefore stood by and heard it and said that it was thunderous. Others said an angel spoke to him. Verse 30, Jesus answered and said, this voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. Now as the judgment of this world, now shall the prince of this world be cast down, cast out. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. This he says, signifying what death he should die. Quickly, Psalms 24, and you'll be seated, and I'll be standing for the next 20 minutes. Come on, say amen. Psalms 27, very familiar psalm. Some believe this also is a messianic psalm, or a psalm that prophesies the death, burial, and resurrection of our Christ. Did I say Psalms 27? I meant Psalms 24, excuse me. Verse 7. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. How many ready for the King of glory? How many ready for the King of glory? Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and even lift them up, ye everlasting doors. The King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. We look at three people before you sit down and just tell them, be lifted. Just be lifted, man. Come on. So I don't know how down you are, but be lifted. Father, we thank you for your grace to teach and minister this word. Just want to move for the next 20 minutes or so. The Lord began to speak, I believe, this message in my heart several weeks ago, not in an attempt necessarily to just have an exciting Easter or Resurrection Day message, but as I begin to really observe what's going on in the lives of many people, I've noticed that seemingly everywhere you look in the world, it appears things are down. In the world, in the world, even today, where everything appears to be down, people are down. How you doing? I'm doing all right. Could be doing better. Family structure is down. Think about it. Marriages are down. Many businesses are down. Churches are down. Look at somebody said, not this church. But there are many churches that are really down today. Down in attendance, down financially, down in spirit. Many people today are emotionally down. They're depressed. They're distressed. People are financially down. They can't hardly pay their bills. They're struggling from paycheck to paycheck. They're down about their careers, their good future. When I say they're down, it doesn't necessarily mean they're frowning every time you see them, but there's just a sense of hopelessness as to, will I ever get out of this state or ever be lifted from this status that I'm in? Their health is down. Their relationships are down. But here's what I want you to know this morning. Here's what the Lord is saying this morning. I want you to know that no matter how down you are, God has the power to lift you this morning. He will lift your life. You didn't hear that. I said he will lift your life. He will lift your life. How can God lift an entire life? He's God. He can lift your family. He can lift your finances. He can lift your health. He can lift your career. He can lift your vision. He can lift your everything concerning your life can be lifted today if you believe. You've had some real down days. This is what the Lord was saying. He says they've had some real down days, many of them lately. But there's a lift that's coming to their lives. There's a lift that's coming to your life that only God can do. I was riding in the plane and I noticed that the higher the lift, the smoother the ride. That's why high quality jets don't fly low. They choose to fly at a higher altitude. Eagles, watch this. Eagles understand there are some storms you can't stop. There's some things in your life that you've been just trying to struggle with and battle with and figure out, and you're just trying to stretch it. And the Lord is saying, stop trying to figure it out. Just go higher. The eagles understand the storm may not cease, but if I choose to fly higher, I can fly above the storm. I'm here to tell you this morning, in the next 3 months, you're getting ready to fly at an altitude in the spirit higher than in this storm in your life. Now, that's for some of you that some things are taught, but other things are caught. But how many just caught that? That there are some storms you have to just fly above. Here's what the psalmist says, the Lord, how they have increased who trouble me. I may have some people that's been get on your nerves. Many are they who rise up against me. They're talking about me, Jesus. Many are they who say of me, they got an opinion of me. There's no help for him in God. Selah. But you, O Lord, are a shield for me. My glory, mark that word, and the lifter up of my head. You are the one, David said, who lifts my head. Somebody shout hallelujah. I'm glad he didn't say he just lifts our hands, because you're supposed to lift your hands, but God has the power to lift your head. That means if he can get a hold of your mind, you can win some battles.
I need to lift your head out of this mess. Get your head out of the sand. What's on your mind? What's holding your mind? Lord, you'll lift my head. And the word lift there is the same word for exalt. It means hupsoo is the Greek word. Hupsoo. Hupsoo. What does it mean? It means to raise to a very summit of opulence and prosperity. In other words, when we're talking about God lifting you today, we're not talking about God just making you feel better. Better. Now, we're not talking about you leaving here feeling better. This lift is a lift that's going to take your life from one place to a place of opulence and prosperity. Oh, God, help me, Jesus. It's a lift. When God lifts you, this is what this word means. When he exalts you, he raises you to a place of dignity, honor, and happiness. Dignity, honor, and happiness. Get ready for dignity, honor, and happiness coming to your life. Now, don't tell me God can't make you happy. Because I tell you, it was so good these last 3 days. Oh, Jesus. I was so happy. See, y'all nasty. I know what y'all thinking about. Y'all nasty. Y'all just... I know what y'all thinking about. No. I was happy because God had lifted my life to a place. And listen, I ain't apologizing for my happiness. I'm not making excuses for my happiness. Listen, look, let's tell the haters that God's about to make me happy. You don't have to apologize for being happy. Some of you make excuses and apologize to people, and you even start making excuses to yourself when you're happy. God says, I can lift your life to a state of happiness. You don't have to be down to look like you're holy. Give somebody a high five and tell them he's going to lift you. He's going to lift you. I'll tell you. Here's what 1 Samuel says. He raises up. I'm going to get to it. Watch this. He raises up the poor out of the dust. He raises up. Same word. Who does? God. He raises up the poor, and poor is relative. Because you can think you're rich and you can go to some places and you look poor. So what he's saying here, he's talking about a state of living, a place of living. Are you listening to me? He says, God has the power to raise the poor out of the dust and lift up the beggar from the dunghill. Watch this. Here it is. Hupsoo. To set them among princes. Look at somebody and tell them God can change your zip code if you want him to. He can change your tax bracket if you believe. Okay, I got some religious people in here. They say, but I got some people that say, God, you can change my zip code if you want. You can change my tax bracket. I believe you're able to lift the poor, to lift the all your. He can change. That's what he's saying. He can lift your financial status. Now, you believe them to get you out of drugs. You believe them to get you out of that relationship. You believe them to set you free. Can you believe that he can lift you out of the dunghill and set you among princes, put you in a place, and watch us, set you up where your whole landscape of your life will be changed? Start talking to people. You're going to start talking to people that can make one decision and change the whole landscape of your life. Somebody shout hallelujah. You got to learn how to give God praise for what's coming. Can you just take about 10 seconds to give God praise for what's on this way? You got to have faith to give him praise for this. Some of you got to believe. Some of you got to see to believe. But the Bible says, blessed are those who believe to see. Can you take, come on, you got 5 more seconds to praise him for what's on this way to your house. There are many things that happen as a result of the resurrection. His love for man forever was validated. If you ever wondered if God loves you, you can look at the cross and see how brutally beaten his son was for you. He died. He was crucified in our place. His love was forever validated. Our forgiveness was secured. Our redemption was sealed. His wrath was satisfied. And our peace was settled. But among the most significant things that have happened was that he was raised so that we could be raised. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. He was what? He was raised so that we could be raised. Look at 2 Ephesians. Ephesians 2 says, and he who he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which once you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of our flesh and of the mind. We were all by nature the children of wrath, just as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy, because his great love was with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses and sin, he made us alive together with Christ, for by grace are you saved. And watch this, and raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Where his great love, say his great love. It was through his love, his hasid, his mercy. It's not any kind of love. It's a stubborn love. It's like a person who it's like a high school person who just likes you and wants to date you and keeps pressing you, and you don't like them. You say, I don't even like them. But they just, but you just hoping that somebody else will come along, but this person just keeps writing your notes and just keeps pressing you, and you're just hoping that somebody else will snatch you up, but this person just keeps on snatching you. Then after a while, you begin to realize, why am I going after somebody who don't really want me? Well, here's a person that wants me. Do you know how bad God wanted you? But I want you to observe the resurrection truth this morning. I want you to look at this. He lifts us on the basis of his mercy. How am I lifted? How am I lifted? You're not lifted because you were good this week. You're not going to be lifted because you had a high spiritual performance this week. You're not going to be lifted on the basis of your scripture knowledge. You're not going to be lifted because you had more I's dotted than more T's, no, T's crossed. No, this morning you will be lifted because his mercy endureth forever. Somebody shout hallelujah. Look at this, look at this. But here's what I want you to get. This is the truth of the text this morning. Before Jesus was raised, he had to go down. In fact, the only glory of the resurrection, listen to this, is God displaying his power to raise or to lift Christ from the dead. There's no glory in being raised if you're not down. Without his death on the cross, there is no glory. And that's why he emphatically says, if I be lifted, I'll draw all men unto me. When God lifts you, he is exalting you to a bigger purpose, something bigger than you. This is what he was telling his disciples. And as I read, and you're hearing in the text, he says, as he was leaving in his last discourse, he looks at them and he says, my time is up. What time are you talking about, Jesus? The time for the Son of Man to be glorified. What do you mean, be glorified? Because most of us, when we think about glory in God, we think about a cloud or somebody falling out under the power of God. But true glory in God requires suffering with God. There is no glory if something doesn't die in your life. That's why he says this, and this is another version. He says, listen carefully, you guys. Unless a grain of wheat is buried in the ground or dead to the world, it is never any more than a grain of wheat. But if it is buried, it sprouts and reproduces itself many times over. In the same way, anyone who holds to their life, just as it is, it destroys that life. But if you let go, watch this, but if you let it go recklessly in your love, you'll have it forever, real and eternal life. He goes on and begins to talk, and he says, right now, I'm troubled. Why are you troubled? Because he understands what it's going to take to produce this glory. Some of you want the glory of God in your life, but you don't understand the price of the glory. When you can discern the price, the vision can flow. Right now, he says, I'm storm-tossed, or your Bible says, I'm troubled. And what am I going to say? He says, Father, am I going to say, get me out of this? No, this is why I came in the first place. Father, I came to put your glory first on display. And then the voice came back to him and says, I have glorified it, and I'll glorify it again. In other words, Jesus, I have shown my glory through your life as you healed the sick, as you raised the dead, as you fed the multitude, as you healed boys and girls and delivered them from demonic spirits. I showed my glory. But this time, this glory is going to lift you in a place, well, watch this, where you'll be captain of everyone's salvation. Can I tell you, you have been through some things, but this glory, this glory to God, this lifting is going to set you up in a place you've never been before. So the angel spoke, and the voice didn't, he says, this voice didn't come from me, but it came for you. And this moment, the world is in crisis. This is what he's saying. But now Satan, the ruler of this world, will be cast down when I am lifted up. And I, if I am lifted up or exalted from the earth, watch this, and when who will attract everyone to me? He's saying, when I am lifted, I'm going to attract everyone to me and gather them around me. Glory to God. Glory to God. What was that glory, saints? The glory that he was referring to was holding our sins. The glory was the weight of our sin. Have you ever known someone in your life, maybe your child or a relative, that you wanted to be saved, but their lifestyle was so contrary to God? But you carry the burden, Lord, if they would just get saved. I mean, you're troubled in your heart because you want them to know this Christ, and you're thinking about how they're drinking and getting high and hanging out in places where they could be snuffed out in a moment. And you got children that you say, oh, God, if they would. And you carry that burden. Well, that's your burden. The burden he carried was for everybody's sin. So he says, I'm troubled. I'm troubled. And I've got to give up what I want to do so that God can accomplish what he wants to do. Glory to God. When you are willing to give up, then you can go up. Some of you want to go up, but you don't want to give up. You know your destiny is to go up, but you won't give up that relationship. You won't give up the time you're taking to get high. You won't give up those crazy weekends. Quiet in this Catholic church this morning now. What are you giving up? You won't give up certain friends that you know don't mean you any good. You won't delete certain folk. You cannot go up. Somebody shout hallelujah. So I want you to see this. I want you to see this. I want you to see this. Jesus has to go through all of this. He has to experience the ultimate down so that he can lift you up. He had to go all the way down so that you can go all the way up. We see his ultimate down at Gethsemane when he was there crying and saying, Lord, my soul, he says, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful. The Bible says his soul was exceedingly sorrowful unto death. In other words, suicide was hanging around. I feel so messed up in my soul. I'm struggling with what I want to do and what I know I'm destined to do. To the point that I'm depressed. That's right. Because 350 million people worldwide suffer from depression. Almost 6% of the world suffers from depression. Listen to me very carefully. Depression is not just feeling down for a little while. Depression is a state of heart, a state of mind that just as soon as you feel like you can climb up, it seems to pull you back down. The devil knows the strings to pull you back down. 15 million Americans are depressed, and then they have something called PDD, persistent depressive disorder. It's DSDD. It means it's a form of depression that usually continues about 2 years. And can I tell you, depression has no respect of persons. You're sitting here today with your nice clothes on. You're sitting here today with your title, with your six-digit job. You're sitting here today, oh, you listen to me, feeling like you got it going on. But the real deal is you are depressed. You go home and you lose everything you've received on Sunday. You go back to the work and you get depressed. You're just not feeling good about your life at large. Depression, saints, are real. CEOs, pastors, even apostles can get oppressed. Anybody can get depressed. And depression is something the church has got to deal with. And Jesus had to go through depression. But he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And there they carried him. That's emotional down. He was emotionally down. But then he had to experience some mental down. Because as they carried him from judgment hall to judgment hall, the Bible says that the soldiers mocked him. And they scorned him and they ridiculed him and they beat him. What is going on? Satan is trying to break him down mentally. Saying things like, you say you're the Son of God. You say you're the king of the Jews. And so they spit him and they took their fist and they balled their hand up and they punched him. And they opened their hand and they slapped him. It was the most hideous and horrific thing you could ever see. And they talked about it. They were trying to break him down mentally. Because watch this, verbal abuse can mess your esteem up. Don't let people talk to you any kind of way. I don't care if they're in your own house. Because verbal abuse can mess you up mentally. It'll have you think, watch it, it'll have you not believing in yourself. You'll have no courage. I know what it is to live on the verbal abuse. Listen, the only way to overcome it is to start saying some things that God has said concerning you. You got to take that word and declare, I am better. I am strong. I can do all. You got to reverse those words. Some of you got word curses that have been spoken over you and they're sitting on your mind mentally. But today, Jesus is going to lift that stuff off you. They physically beat him, took the cat of nine tails, which was a long whip, a leather whip that had rocks and glass. And they took him and they slashed him 39 times. And every time they slashed him, the skin was peeled off his back. He was physically down. And they dragged him to the cross, and history says that the cross was about 100 pounds. And there he was, after being beaten all night, had to drag that 100-pound cross. And watch this, which was equivalent, they said he had to walk 2 football fields to get to Calvary. And when he gets to Calvary, they stretch him on this pole. And they stretch his body so so that his, watch this, so that his rib cage was stuck. So he could hardly breathe. But after all that was happening to him, he bore the weight of it all just for you and me. He would not say a mumbling word. And there he is on the cross. They took the nails and they yammed it in his hands. They took the nail as spikes and they yammed it in his legs and in his feet. And there his body was disfigured. He was so bad beaten in his face, it looked like a bloody beach ball. His head was swollen. Isaiah said he was so disfigured, you couldn't even recognize him. He was dehydrated. He was physically down. But watch this, even in that physical down state, they could not kill him until he gave up the ghost. He says, no man taketh my life, but I lay it down. I don't care who's physically beating you. You are not so down that you can't overcome and be lifted. But it doesn't stop there. He kept going down. For he died on Calvary on Friday. And there he died, but the Bible says he was buried in the grave and he descended into the lower parts of hell. That earthly inferno that most of us have no clue of where hell is. It is not just, watch it, it is not just geographical, but hell is also invisible. It is in a whole other dimension. It is not just a dark place. It is a place that's described as being outer darkness. You don't even understand that kind of darkness. Some of y'all get scared when the lights are turned off. But can you imagine a darkness that you can't even fathom in a place where you are so dark and demons are everywhere? But the Bible says in that low state of hell, his spirit had to go low. And even in that low spiritual place, the word was so powerful. The light was so powerful that in hell, he preached to the spirits. I don't care how low spiritual you are right now. I'm going to tell you, there's a word in you that can be used of God even in your lowest state. God can still use you. Jesus is in hell and he's still preaching. I'm going to say that again for somebody who feels like God can't use them because you're low spiritually. Jesus was in hell and he still preached. And some of you have had to preach through hell. You have had to praise through hell. You have had to pray through hell. You have had to worship through hell. But can I tell you, if you can preach through hell, if you can pray through hell, if you can praise through hell, if you can worship through hell, you are just on the brink of being lifted by God. God says your darkest hour is just before your dawn. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Can I prophesy to somebody? But after he died, after he went to hell, the Bible said in 3 days, he rose. In other words, he got up. In other words, God lifted him. That's why Psalmist said, Lord, you will not see, you will not allow or leave my soul in hell. No, will you allow my soul to see corruption? But he says that in your, you will lift me and show me the path of life. For in your presence, there's fullness of joy. And at your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. Here's what I want you to see. That if Jesus can go down emotionally, if he can go down mentally, if he can go down spiritually, and still be lifted. I'm here to tell you this morning, if you're down spiritually, if you're down emotionally, if you're down physically, there's an anointing this morning that's going to lift you up. For the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, if it dwells in you, it will quicken your body. And today God told me to tell you that your down days are over. Your down days are over. I'm going to lift you spiritually. I'm going to lift you mentally. I'm going to lift you emotionally. I'm going to lift you financially. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to lift you out of sorrow into joy. I'm going to lift you out of poverty into prosperity. I'm going to lift you out of depression into happiness. Today, if you give God a praise, He will lift you. Now watch this. David said, why are you cast down? This was Jesus. Even when he was in hell, he was talking to a soul. He said, why are you cast down? Why are you disquieted within me? Because I don't care how spiritual you are, you can have some down moments. He says, hope thou in God, for I will yet praise him, for he is the help of my countenance. Now watch this. You will get up if you can believe in the process. Okay, you didn't hear that. If you can understand that down moments, down seasons, down periods are only power moments, power building seasons for the believer, you are never down to stay down.
Amen. Yes, sir.
In fact, God has put an expiration date on your downness. And here's what he told me. He says, for everyone who offers me a praise this morning, he says, today is your day. That he's going to lift you out of one place into another place. If you can give him a praise, somebody shout hallelujah. Oh, you didn't hear me. You didn't hear me. You didn't hear me. This praise is going to be so anointed. See, if the devil knew how anointed you are, he would not have crucified the Lord of glory. He would not have messed with you and brought you so far down if he understood the anointing on you to bring you back up. But get three people and tell them, I'm anointed. And I'm getting ready to go up. Come on, get somebody else and tell them, I'm anointed. And I'm getting ready to go up. Now I need you to give God a praise, because this next praise is getting ready to raise you up out of everything that's held you down. Everything that's captivated you. Everything that's depressed you. Everything that's oppressed you. If you will give God a shout, I hear God saying, I'm lifting. I'm lifting. I'm lifting. I'm lifting. I'm lifting. I'm lifting. I'm lifting your finances. It is supernatural. It is not by power. It is not by might, but it's by God's Spirit. The anointing is about to lift everything that's held you down. Today is your day of rising. Today is your day of exaltation. Today is your day of promotion. Now give God a shout for promotion. Come on, shout, shout. Okay, 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 okay. Can I tell you why some of you are not shouting? Because you don't understand the power of Calvary and the power of the resurrection. Jesus has already forgiven you. He has already provided the mercy seat. So it doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you've been. Today the word says, if you praise me, if you praise me, I will lift you.
Watch this. I'm not going to lift you based on your life, because your life ain't worth nothing. The only life that I'm looking at is the life that I gave you. So if you're going to praise him, you got to praise him for the life that's already in you. Now I need you at the count of three to give him a shout, because he's about to raise the roof off your life. He's about to raise the sky off your life. He's about to lift you to a place of dimension. Oh, I hear it right now. Are you listening to me? One, two, three, shout the praises. Come on, elevate. Elevate yourself. Elevate. 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 Every time you praise him, you kill an area of your flesh. That's why the Bible calls it a sacrifice of praise, to give God thanks in the midst of what you're going through. A sacrifice means, watch this, that whatever has been preventing you from getting closer will die at the point of praise. And this morning, this next praise will be a sacrifice of praise. It will be a praise that whatever has been holding you, it will die at the altar. Somebody shout hallelujah. Your flesh is about to die. Your mind, your carnal mind is about to die. Your relationship is about to die. Your last income level is about to die. Are you ready to give God a shout of praise? Are you ready to lift him? One, two, three, shout out. I need somebody that believes. Praise is the language of faith. I said, praise is the language of faith. I said, praise is the language of faith. I praise him because I believe him. I praise him because I thank him. I praise him because I receive my miracle. I receive my breakthrough. I receive my lifting. Give him a shout of praise. Thank you, Jesus. Lift your hands. If you're here this morning, listen to me. The Holy Spirit has an assignment on your life this morning. That assignment is to lift you. To lift you. To lift you. Now, Pastor, why am I here this morning? I could have been anywhere in Baltimore or Washington. Why did you allow me to hear this word this morning? Can I tell you why? Because it's your time. You've gone through process, and now it's time for you to rise. You cried. Yes, Lord. I need people here today that will come to the Mizbah, which is the altar that will allow it to die. That will allow it to die. They say, whatever I came in here with is dead because God's raising me above it. It may be a relationship. It may be a sickness. It may be a place financially that God has been telling you that you're greater than. It may be in a struggle or habit that's keeping you from going up. But today is over. Yes, it's over now. It's over now. I can't say how, but I'm over it now. Your hands, come on. Yes, I'm over it now. I'm over I can't say how, but I'm over it now. Come on, lift your hands if you believe that today. Say it. Yes, I'm over. He already gave me the victory. I'm over it now. I can't say how, but I'm over it now. Lift your hands and worship him. I cried my last tear. Yes, I cried my last tear. I cried my last tear. I can't say how, but I'm over it now. Everybody that knows you're over with, you have a thing that's been holding you back, but today you're saying yes to Jesus. I want you young people, I want you middle age, wherever you are. And today you're saying, Lord, I give it to you. It's over. Lift me to the place you want to lift me. I want you to come to the altar right now. Just quickly come and say, Jesus, I believe it's over. Come on, make it, just come. Yes, it's over. Yes, it's over. Yes, it's over. Yes, I'm over here now. Yes, I'm over here now. I can't say how, but I'm over it now. Come on, lift your hands, everybody. Come on, there's some of you that need to go. Yes, I'm over. That's it. Come to the mizpah. Let him kill it right here. I'm over. I can't say how. Yes, but I'm over. God is still talking to somebody. You come to the altar for things to die. And your very presence at the altar means that it's getting ready to die. Whether it's a sickness, whether it's a drug habit, whatever it is, today it dies. Now this time we're going to sing. The brother, can you help me out? Somebody give my brother a mic. I need him to sing. I'm over. Oh. Yes, I'm over. Come yes, on, I'm everybody. Over. Come on, keep coming. Yes, I'm over. That broken relationship, that divorce, that bankruptcy.
I can't say how. But I'm over it now. Over my situation.
Come on,
over
this
my circumstances. Yes, yes, I'm over.
Thank you, Jesus.
Over it now.
I'm over. They're still
I
coming.
Can't see how.
I can't. Say, Lord, I bless you. That is over.
I cried
my last tear. Yes, I cried
my last tear.
Oh, I cried my
last tear. I can't say how.
Thank you, Lord.
But I'm over it now.
I'm over. One more time. Lift your hands. The Spirit of the Lord is moving. I ain't gonna cry over it no more.
I ain't gonna cry. Oh, but I'm over it now.
They're still coming. They're still coming. I'm not gonna pray a long prayer. But the Spirit of God.
Yes, I cried. I ain't gonna cry no more about it.
It's over today.
Today
it's over.
Is my day. Today is my day. I can't say how.
I know
but
he's delivering.
I'm over it now.
Now somebody give God a praise all over this place. Give God a shout of praise. I want the ministers to begin to pray because the Spirit of the Lord is about to hit this altar. And everything that held you captive is going to loose you in a moment. Whatever you came here, when you go back, it's going to be done. It's going to be dead in the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, I lift up, lift your hands to him. I lift up these lies before you. They have come because they know you have grace and power and mercy to kill what has been holding them. God, I pray that you would raise them up. Let there be a supernatural lift. I pray for a divine lift, that they will no longer fight it, but they will just go higher above it. And so today, in the name of Jesus, I loose you from every entanglement. I loose you from every spirit that has held you captive. I bind depression, and I bind fear. I bind hurt, and I decree in the name of Jesus that you are free. I decree in the name of Jesus that the Lord lifts you up. That the Lord is lifting you. That the Lord is setting you free. That the Lord is healing you. That the Lord is setting you free. That the Lord is giving you the victory. That the Lord God of glory is bringing glory into your life. Lift up your head. Lift up your head, all ye gates, and be lifted up. The King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong. The Lord strong. The Lord mighty. Mighty in power. Mighty to deliver you. Mighty to set you free. Mighty to give you the victory. Now give God a praise for your victory at the altar. Say, give him a praise because you got victory. I said, give him praise for your victory this morning. Hallelujah! 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 Give him a praise for the lifting. You're getting ready to get eagle wings. God's giving you eagle wings. Hallelujah! Pray that wait upon the Lord. Shall renew their strength. God, we thank you for victory this morning. In the name of Jesus, we decree a lifting. And for those of you that are in sin, for those of you that were in bondage, the Lord sets you free this morning. He frees you from the guilt, he frees you from the condemnation, and he frees you from all shame. Today, you are lifted. Now give God a shout for the lift. Now some of you, listen to me very carefully before you go back, before you go back. Some of you, there's an ego, watch this. There's an ego anointing that's on you now. That when you go back home, it may not even look like nothing's changed. But you're gonna notice that you're flying above that. And I want you to look that thing in the face and you say, I'm above that now. Somebody shout hallelujah. Give somebody a high five and tell them I'm flying above that today. Come on, tell them I'm flying above that. I'm flying, I'm living above that. Listen, if you're here at the altar, if you're here at the altar and you are not a member of this church, or you don't go to this church, but today you're giving your life, maybe you go to this church, but today you're giving your life to the Lord. Today you are committing to join this church and you're at this altar. Will you turn to my left and to your right quickly and follow that man with his hands up? Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout of praise. Come on, it's all right. Let's give God a shout. God did what he wanted to do today.